This episode of the HoneyDew is brought to you by Tushy, Upstart, Manscaped, and Keeps. More on that later. Let's get into the do.
The HoneyDew with Ryan Sickler.
Welcome back to the HoneyDew, y'all. We're over here doing it in the Night Pants Studios. I am Ryan Sickler, RyanSickler.com, Ryan Sickler on all social media. Night Pants Nation, I can't thank you enough for all of your support. For real, you guys are the best. And you know what else feels really good? Every time I go out and about somewhere and somebody comes on the show or they'll hit me up and they'll say, man, you got the best fans. And I do. So thank you, for real. Make sure you are subscribed to the YouTube channel. You're getting video over there every Tuesday, audio on Monday. Make sure you're subscribed to the Patreon page, guys. There are two HoneyDews a week. One is on the Patreon page. I'm keeping it as cheap as I can. You're getting video and audio. It's $5 a month. No tiers, no nothing. 60 a year. You're getting 52 episodes a year extra. All right. And I'm just doing the HoneyDew with y'all. The HoneyDew Podcast, let me slow my words down, is the website, and that's where the merch is, all that stuff, the hoodies, the night shorts. I mean, you guys are the fucking best. I'm sitting here thinking of night pants. You guys are like, hey, why don't we cut the legs off of them? And I'm like, yeah, why don't we cut the fucking legs? Let's cut the night pants off at the knees, y'all. Got nice shorts out there, hoodies, everything. So thank you, thank you, thank you. And as always, I record here at the Santa Monica Music Center. If you are looking to take some online music lessons, this is the spot. You'll be trained by local Los Angeles musicians. And if you go to santamonicamusic.com, you use the code HoneyDew, they will waive the registration fee and give you one free lesson when you sign up for a package. All right. Now, you all know what we do over here. We highlight the lowlights. And as I always say, these are the stories behind the storytellers. I am very excited to have this storyteller on today for the first time here on the HoneyDew, y'all. Let's welcome Thomas Araujo, everybody. Welcome to the HoneyDew, brother.
Appreciate you, man.
Thank you. Did I say it right?
You did.
Did pretty good for a white dude.
Just like I say it.
Well, welcome to the show. Thank you to Marty, actually,
yes,
for connecting
Marty.
Us. Marty O'Neill, the shit. Thank you, Marty. I like the crossover here. And yeah, what I didn't know is I didn't know this was your first guest on a... I didn't know that.
Yeah.
So I was very flattered and excited because I know you're stoked to be here.
Dope.
Yeah, dude. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
So before we get into your stories, because you have quite a bit to tell, please promote everything and anything you want.
Go to dopeasyola.com, pushtrees.com, that's my clothing company, dopeasyola on YouTube, and yola YouTube on Instagram, if it's still there. Like I told you.
Yeah, you've been telling me they
fucking deleted it.
They shut you down.
Yeah.
I didn't know that at all.
Yeah, it's a what the fuck? Yeah, that's all. It's all right.
Well, I want to talk to you. I think the easiest way, I ask everybody to send me stuff. I'm pointing over to the monitor with your stuff on there. And yours is a hell of a chronological story, as some people's are and some aren't. So why don't you start from the beginning for us, please?
Okay. I'm from Merced, California. You said you do know where that's from. It's a shithole. But it's where I'm from. It's just full of meth and gangs. It runs on meth and like EBT cards and shit. That's the whole town. I don't know. I grew up there. I don't speak Spanish, but I'm brown as shit. So it was very hard for me to not get like, every time someone speaks Spanish, I don't fucking know what you're saying.
Looking down on you.
Oh, when I went to Cancun
like
recently, holy shit. Everywhere I walked, I went, huh?
Do they walk up to you and speak to you in Spanish? Yeah.
And I go, I'm so, what the fuck?
What's that
saying?
Feel like inside to
it's
have to
the
tell
worst.
Them?
It's the worst, man. At customs, the lady looked at me and go, Mexican. I go, yeah. Like that.
Out loud.
Yeah.
Oh, couldn't even throw a C out right there. I mean, come
so
on, man.
Bad, man.
And then there's a white guy behind you, like,
dude, I'm telling you, I don't fit the description. I know that shit, but it's okay.
That's happened a lot, though.
Yeah.
And you just feel it inside. You have to say, how many times would you have to say you think in your life I don't speak Spanish?
Thousands.
That's a lot.
No, I grew up in a town, a Mexican town.
Yeah.
It's a field worker town, and There's me. Yeah. But Merced's good. I guess it's where you grow up. I'm sure
it's home. It's your home for you.
I love
you.
Going back. It's fucking awesome. But other than that, there's not a lot of opportunity. But that's why I left. That's why I live in LA. So.
Well, what was it like for you growing up there? Because things were you were exposed to shit very young.
Yes. Like I said, gangs and drugs. So gangs was the first thing I no drugs. Sorry, take it back. So my best friend Preston. I'm sorry. His dad Preston, big Preston. He's a fucking giant dude. I was playing at his house. I was about four. And you know when you're a kid, like, fuck that water hose. There's 12 people on that shit. I'm going inside to get some water. I walked in, and I just saw this Mexican dude on the table just like this. It's a little-ass brown fat me just walks in, and this guy has this big pile of white. I don't know what the fuck I'm looking at. And he just does this. And I stop, and then I just see Preston. He puts his hand over my face. Starts walking me out, and my mom's real mean. I forgot to mention that. And he's like, your mom's gonna fucking kill me. And he just threw me outside by my face.
Oh, big Preston.
Big Preston.
Scared of your
he's
mom.
6'6". Oh, yeah. No, for sure.
6'6".
Big Preston. Yeah, yeah. Not little. Not my best friend. His dad. He's a giant man. And he said, your mom's gonna fucking kill me. And threw me out. I think that was the first place I ever saw weed and zigzags. So, I mean, it's not a big deal, but the coke fucking... I just knew that's the shit on Scarface. I've seen Scarface before. Let's get the
at
fuck
four,
out of here.
Yeah.
Yeah. My mom did not. I grew up on movies like The Cable Guy. It's exactly like that. Like, hey, watch this. I'm like, fuck, all right. Natural-born killers, here we go. Oh shit. I'm just getting fucking brainwashed. But yeah, dude. Drugs. Drugs runs that town, but I mean I ended up.
And you're exposed that young.
Yeah, but it's not like it fucked me up. I knew drugs were bad. I still didn't smoke weed till I was way older. I knew it was bad, so I knew, hey, just get the fuck away from this guy. It's because my mom will beat my ass. That's all I know. My mom will fucking kill me. Do anything wrong, she's going to stab me. She's going to break my legs. She says that shit to me all the time.
She would say it to you?
I'll break your legs. She always said that shit. I'll break your fucking legs. Which brings me to the next thing, the gangs. This is when it first happened.
You get jumped in the house.
My mom will wake me up with a fucking belt. It's happened many times. I was playing with a match. And she found out. She woke me up with a fucking studded belt on my back.
A studded belt.
She's a fool, man. She is a 90s mom. You know what I'm saying? She was 18, though, so I understand.
Your mom was 18?
When she had me.
Yeah.
But 16 with my sister. So they were kids. I understand.
Yeah, she is a kid.
They were kids in a drug town. The fuck do you expect? You know what I mean?
Trying to keep their kids off the drugs.
Yeah, no, my mom, she's the reason I don't have 10 kids, and I'm not in a gang, I'm not in jail, because she fucking punched me in the face all day. Punched me in the face if I did some crazy shit, so I knew to stay away.
What's the hardest your mom's ever hit you for real?
Okay, that's a good one. When she kicked me the fuck out one time when I was 16, because my life, I'm afraid of her, like, you know, like an older brother, like, oh, I'm bigger, but he'll fuck me up. But my mom's scary. She's loud, and she's scary. And she punched me in the fucking face because I didn't mow the lawn because it didn't fucking work. And I'm telling her, it doesn't work. What do you want me to do? And she just cracked me in the fucking face, dude. And it did nothing. And that's the day I stopped being afraid of my mom. I was 16 years old. That was it. I told her, too.
You took her best shot.
I fucking hulked out on her. I didn't hit my mom. But
no,
like,
yeah.
Fuck
you're like,
you.
Oh, that's it. It's the last one.
Oh, shit. That's it. It's over. You don't care anymore, because I even told her, that's fucking it. And then I grabbed my
this
shoes.
This shit ain't over yet. You'll see, motherfucker. My ride ain't over.
Dude, she's crazy. She's back then.
My
little brother now is 16. He got the cool, nice version of her, which is dope. You know, it's fucking awesome seeing that shit. But yeah, my mom was, she was an asshole. Yeah, and I tell her to her face, like, you're a fucking dickhead. All the time, man. But like I said, we have a relationship that's like, stop fucking doing that, and it won't. There's the outcome. What the fuck do you expect? Mm-hmm. So it was kind of like a brother sister thing, but yeah, like I said, the first time she told, "I'll break your fucking legs," she used to say that often, but she said it for the first time for real, and she grabbed me by my fucking shirt. Is when I was leaving school, second grade, and this fucking kid in a red shirt. I was in the second fucking grade, and this kid comes up to me and goes, "What do you bang?" And I go, "What the fuck does that mean? What are you talking about? I'm just with my backpack full of Power Ranger shit. What are you talking about? You know, I'm fucking in second grade." And he goes, "What do you bang?" And I said, what are you talking about? I had a bad mouth. I said, "What the fuck are you talking about?" And he goes, "I claim red." I go, "All right." And I fucking kept walking. And I got home. I told my mom. She straight fucking put me, like, grabbed me by the shirt. I'll break your fucking legs if you join
the game. We crip all over here every day.
Wrong
set. I ever hear that blood shit. I will break your fucking...
Thank you for that. That was such a fucking better way of looking at it, man. Because it just scared the shit out of me. Yo, she was... like I said, she's a fucking... It's a gang town. And she's trying to keep... And my dad was dumb. When he was young, he tried to do gang stuff. But my dad's like me. He's very nice.
So my Were your parents together?
No, they broke up when I was like 3 or 4. Because... Sorry. My dad and my mom used to fight like crazy. And...
You said they broke up. I mean, it sounds funny because she was 18, but she was 18. That is a breakup.
They fucked each other up.
Your mom would fight with your dad, too?
Really? Yeah, a lot. I've never even talked about this shit. Wow. My bad. My dad's good now. He's like a fucking straight edge. It's great. But, no, I see my dad beat the fuck out of my mom, and I see my mom fuck my dad up. My mom knocked my dad out unconscious many times.
Many?
Bro, my mom is fucking she's fucking... She's like a little Rosie Perez, but she'll fucking beat the shit out of you. And that's how I grew up. Like, be polite. Hold the fucking door open.
How'd she knock him out? What do you remember seeing?
She just punched him in the face.
Punch him in the face?
Yeah, she tried to run over the... They were wild kids, you know? But me growing up, I just go, oh, they're fighting.
She's falling.
X-Men off, fucking like, play fucking Sega.
Your dad's got a glass jaw.
Oh, fucking out of here. No, my dad beat the shit out of her, too, though.
Jesus.
Yeah. The last time, I remember when they broke up.
So they were never married?
No, they broke up. My dad was 23. Okay. My mom was 21, probably. They were fucking kids. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But I walked in, and my dad was beating the shit out of my mom with his belt, and they were both naked. And I was like, what the fuck is happening? I was a little kid. I was a kid.
That might have been the one time he wasn't beating the shit out of your mom. That might have been the one time your mom was actually asking for
it. Extracurricular shit they were doing? No. That's not what it was.
Oh, shit.
Jesus Christ, man. No. Then he started punching her in the face, right? And then I jumped on her. I was like, hey, knock it off. And my dad started crying.
Wait, you jumped in the middle of your...
My dad was beating the fuck naked out of her. Oh, man. You know how awkward it was?
I can't imagine.
I jumped on my mom. I didn't look at her. And I stared at my dad.
Put your dick away, Dad.
And I was like, stop it. And he just started like tearing. Shit. And they broke up that day. And that was it. Because he threw my older sister. But when I stopped him, he threw my fucking sister across the room all twacked out.
So was it a substance abuse? Drinking, drugs?
No, they used to do meth.
Oh, it was meth.
My dad used to crank a lot.
And so, but your mom never called for help, huh? She fought back.
She fucked him up.
That's what I'm saying.
She
beat the shit out of my dad. Yeah, she wasn't like,
She beat the fuck out of my dad, man. I've seen my mom hulk up on a few people.
Hulk up on them.
No. One day you'll see. I'll just show you a picture for it later. I can see it. She's scary, man. She's like fucking Roseanne. She's just scary. But that was the first time, and she told me, I'll break your fucking legs, to circle back. It was the gangs.
So you went home and said something about this.
I asked her, I go, what does that mean to bang? And she straight just fucking grabbed me and told me, I'll break your fucking legs. And then, when she taught me not to hit girls too, because my dad used to beat my mom, she told me, you want to hear? All right, here's the technique. She said, I'm 4. This is right when they broke
up.
Your mom's telling me this. In Fresno, we used to live in Fresno for a year. So they broke up after that fight. And my mom's lecturing me on like not to hit girls. That's why I don't hit girls, because she's scary. She told me she'll fucking kill me. I will stab you. I will kill you. I'll send you to jail if you hit your girlfriend.
Do you understand how strong women especially are?
She raised me my whole life.
But think about like how strong women are to fucking to be beaten and then still look at your kid and go, don't do that.
Yeah,
To literally take a beating and still have to be the parent and go, 100%. Hey, what you see happening to me fucked up.
Yes.
Do not do this to women. Good God, exactly. The burden.
Exactly, man.
No wonder she wanted to whip people's ass.
She's scary, man.
What's your mom's name?
Emily.
Emily. I got the nicest little...
Emily Ann.
That's the nicest, sweetest little name.
I know. But she's a she's the reason why it came out not shitty. For real.
That's it only takes one, y'all. Dude. It only takes one parent.
Say some
one
shit.
Good
say
one.
Some shit.
One good one. Yeah.
No, my dad,
one good one.
My dad's great. My dad's great. Them together is fucking explosive. Other than that, my dad is the nicest. Never fucking does that again. Them together was just all bad. You know? They're just not right for each other. They're born 5 days apart. They're just too much alike.
Oh, really?
Yeah. They're just too much alike.
They're
kids.
Like brother and sister. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's really how I started seeing my mom just teach me shit. But the way, like I said, the way she told me not to hit girls, she said, girls are fucking stupid. They'll hit themselves to make it look like you hit them. You go to jail. And I'm sitting there. No, they wouldn't. No,
at
they
four.
Wouldn't. And my mom, yes. I remember looking up at her, fucking X-Men on Sega to the right of me. There's windows behind us. We're in fucking Clovis. She's telling me this, and she's crying as she does it. And I'm sitting there like, what the fuck is happening? What the fuck did you do? What did I do? You know? But now I get it that she's fucking tripping. She's having to explain this to me, right? And she tells me what you do is they'll hit themselves, right? She says you sit on their chest. You push your head, your hand on their head so they don't slam it into the ground. You put your knees on their shoulders. You call the cops. And that's it. So don't hit them because you're going to go to jail. But they will hurt themselves. And I'm sitting there like, bullshit. No girl would just hurt themselves to make somebody get in trouble. You know what? I'm trying to process this shit. I'm trying to process, like, my dad is not here. You know? But the next day, I'm just playing, like, catching my dad. So I didn't think of it. Oh, they're fighting. Me and my sister fight, too. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So it didn't really bug me. It didn't bother me.
It was unfortunately, it was normal to you.
Yeah, it didn't. Yeah. And I didn't see it all the time.
Right.
You know? And it wasn't like they were beating each other all the time. But when we weren't around, they were fucking each other up. So that's how I learned the don't hit girls, don't join gangs shit from my mom.
Yeah.
But.
Because you could have gone the other way.
She did a good job. I mean, dude, people my whole life ask.
Right now, you could be naked in some bedroom beating somebody right now.
I could be doing this
with
same
a kid
shit.
Running in. Your son running in.
Oh,
telling
man.
You, stop.
Dude, I'll never forget that shit. That was awkward.
That is,
it was
yeah.
awkward.
That is a lot of layers. It also. If they were fully clothed
not
normally, that's a fucked up
not
situation.
On a waterbed. So, so when I jumped on it, I couldn't fucking get to her. I was
nah,
like, oh,
is
shit.
That right?
I swear to God. It was a waterbed.
Dad, stop. I'm
I
getting
was.
Sick. I'm getting sick. I'm getting sea queasy, goddamn.
Fuck out of here. Oh, fuck.
Dude, that is terrible. That's terrible.
But it's funny
what
as
a
fuck.
Way. It's, it, thank God
it's
you see it that
funny.
Way. It
no
is...
matter what. I mean, if I told you a story, I saw this guy beating his lady. They were fucking naked. Like, what happened? It's funny.
This little kid came in.
This little
kid
came in, saved the
bouncing
day.
Around on a waterbed and saved the day. Holy
it's funny,
shit.
Man. It's funny.
Yeah. All right. So there's so you're obviously introduced to drugs and violence, domestic violence.
Yeah, but
very early.
Yeah, they broke up after that. But then my mom's not nice. When I was a kid, she was very mean. So it was just now my mom, but my dad was the fun one. But he's not there. So yeah, it went, and then we moved to LA for a year and a half. My mom met some guy. I saw the guy walk into a room. They introduced it. They stared at each other. It was like a movie. Like Goodfellas started. And then there he was. And then it just starts. That's what happened. They stared at each other. And my mom moved to LA. We lived in Merced. They looked at each other once. Said hi.
You remember that?
I remember it looking at. Why is my mom looking
like
this
is a
man?
Brand new person.
Because yeah. I didn't know who he was. I'm looking at this Tim Curry looking fucking dude. And I look at my mom. And then we moved to LA with the guy. Fucking
with him.
Oh, we moved into his
So where'd you meet him?
In Merced.
That's where they met.
It was
first.
My mom's friend's boyfriend's friend. That's yeah. it. But I remember they walked in the door. I saw like, get the fuck out. Are you guys serious? But I'm a kid. I'm just looking at it like, why are my mom doesn't look at anybody like that. And then we moved to LA. And then that's when shit got rough, man. It was my mom was,
I mean
it got bad. Like, because
it's been so easy so far.
No, it got rougher. It got rough to the... All right, look at... My mom
for
and
you
him
too?
Were smoking meth. I didn't know that at the time.
Right.
So, like, food wasn't like, hey, did the kids fucking eat today? But as a kid, I just know you're hungry and shit. You know what I mean? At school, I get to eat fucking hamburgers at lunch. I come home, I just wait to go to fucking school. But not all the time. They're fucking weird. He was a weird motherfucker, man. I didn't like the guy. Robert, he's a dick. I one time peed on the fucking floor of my room and blamed it on his cat so he'd have to clean it up. And I pissed up the wall a little. And my mom straight believed that it was his cat and said, my son wouldn't fucking do that. And then I'm watching this man clean my piss. And then that's how I got back at him. He was a piece of shit. I fucking hated the guy.
Smells not like Gatorade. I'm not going to lie.
No, he said, my cat's a fucking girl, Thomas. And I go, why would I piss on the wall? But like in the corner. You know what I'm saying? I was fucking six. I thought it'd be funny. You know, I thought it'd be funny. It is funny. Especially watching him fucking do it, looking at me, knowing that it was me. But my mom will beat the shit out of him if he tries
to
spank me or anything. My mom's gonna fuck you up. So he knew better.
The cat.
It was great.
Yeah, it was great. I fucking hated that cat.
But no, he put a fucking chain on the refrigerator so we couldn't open it unless they were there, like unless he opened it. It was weird, man. It was very like looking back. I see pictures like a stick figure kid, but I didn't know. That's why I'm fat as shit. I think because I got home, my grandma's like, what do you want? Like fucking Sunny Delight and McDonald's. Yeah. What the fuck you think I want? You know what I mean? Watch Sandlot all day and eat this shit. So when my mom broke up with him, we came back to Merced. My mom was straight. She was good. She was working to stop doing drugs completely.
That's good.
Yeah, but she was still fucking mean. Like the punching.
Emily Ann?
She's nice now. She's very nice now. But when we were kids, she was not. But that's Merced and how I started growing up. And remember I told you she hates gangs, all that shit. So then she meets her husband, her soon-to-be husband, and I try to tell you, like, I'm fucking brown. You can see that I'm brown. I'm a brown kid. My mom looks like a white lady because my whole other side's Jewish, and then my other side's Mexican.
Okay, Jewish.
So white. Well, I'm saying Jewish, but they're like Polish and something. They're all. I'm not doing the 7 days of Hanukkah. I tried to do it with my grandma. She's sitting in a seat, another fucking language, and I made fun of it once, and then she got so mad she never did it again. And we had a regular Christmas for the rest of my life, man. So my mom looks like a white lady for somewhat. So she marries this guy. I'm just going to call him my stepdad because I don't want to. You'll see why.
Sure.
He's a fucking prison bird. You could see it, right? I'm playing hacky sack. I'm like 8. I'm playing hacky sack in the fucking yard, just trying to do tricks. And this guy walks in with my mom. Fucking Axel Rose walks in, basically.
He had long hair like that.
Long fucking hair. White dude. Blue eyes. And I looked at him. Fuck are you standing with him like that? Like, oh shit, it's her boyfriend. You know what I mean? Like, this is it. This is the introduction. My mom had hella different boyfriends.
Is that Greg Allman?
Oh fuck. No, dude, he had overalls on. Overalls and a shirt under.
You remember, huh? You really do have a good memory.
Photographic, man. And he's doing hacky sack over his head, showing me. I fell in love with the guy instantly. He goes, oh, this is your boyfriend? Fuck yeah. He just showed me how to do all the tricks.
Watch this trick right here and learn this in the yard right now.
And then I didn't know what else you're going to do in prison.
Yeah. So you're good at hacking.
She dates him for 2-3 months and then he goes to jail. Right? But I just know he's
Then do you know how they met?
My mom was dating some guy and he started getting really weird and that was his cousin. My mom was a dumbass at the time. And he beat the shit out of the guy because he wouldn't leave her alone. And that became her new boyfriend. Like, what the fuck are you doing to me? My dad was always so mad. Like, why the fuck are you? Was my kids around these people? But I just thought it was like my cool stepdad. You know, he plays hacky sack. He's tight. Now I get it. I'd be pissed because he went to jail. And that's when I realized that he was not just some white, random white dude. Because he was covered in tats. I didn't know what they meant. But now when I get older, it's like some American History X fuck just... Just bolts and tat and bolts, lightning bolts. White is
white right. Supremacist.
Oh, dude, 100%.
But your mom's Jewish.
You think I don't fucking know this? My grandma's Jewish. You know how fucking mad she was. Oh, just devastated. But
how?
Out of prison, 100% straight edge, trying to go to college. Race doesn't mean anything. He explained this to me later. When he's in jail, he's like, "When jail, it's different. You have to, or you're on your own." He explained this to me.
Like he's 12. Like, now, did I need to get this profile of Hitler on my back? Right
bro.
Now? No, I didn't.
He straight up, it was bad. He, like, white is right, real big across
white
the body.
Is right?
Because I asked him, what does that mean? And that's when he started explaining to me, like, well, when you're in jail, I'm like, what the fuck are you talking about, man? What are you talking about, Mary? I'm fucking 9, 8. I don't get it. I didn't understand that people will fucking murk you if you're a different color. I knew what racism was, obviously, but...
Yeah, when prison's got its own country, world, planet. Yeah,
I didn't know what it was about. I just knew my stepdad was this white dude. And we go into town, we always get stared at. Everywhere we go, we get stared at. You know, I didn't know.
Of course. Right, of course. But sure.
Because all the tattoos.
But what is, did you ever ask your mom, like, what the fuck were you thinking with that guy?
I sat down with her last year, and she said, good. It was kind of mainly to piss my mom off. That's what the fucking asshole said to me. My grandma, they didn't have a good relationship. She's like, you know what? It's my fucking boyfriend. Turned into her fucking husband. The coolest guy in the world. I fucking love that guy. He was the shit. No, let me explain to you why. Like, you like this white supremacist, you piece of shit? Let me explain to you. When I met him, I didn't know what the fuck was going on. We go to visit him in prison because we're writing him letters. Like, no, my mom's boyfriend went to jail.
Your mom's taking you to prison to see him too?
Corcoran. And my dad is every fucking chance he gets is screaming at my mom. And yeah. I'm just like, he's cool, Dad. Leave him alone. But little do I know, like, why are you taking my kids to the fucking prison visiting center? So when I first, prison family visits, got some bomb ass sandwiches. Let me just say that right now. I went a few times just to get the fucking sandwiches. And I'm not kidding at all, bro. I wake up at 5:30.
He's Mendocino Farms over here, man.
That tri-tip. Fuck yeah, I'm going to see him today. I swear to God, it was... Anyway, first time I went to see him. I'm excited. It's my stepdad, basically. I go to see him, and he looks different. He walks in different. Like, he's walking in, like, slow. And I'm looking, I'm like, what the fuck is going on? This guy's walking in not like the guy I know, all happy and fun, because he's a fun motherfucker. He's a genius. He's smart as shit. He can draw anything in the world. He does tattoo. He's great. Cool guy. Goes to jail, and then it was just different.
Let's take a quick break and tell you about our first sponsor, Upstart. During these economically turbulent times, everyone's looking for a way to feel more financially secure. So if you're still needlessly throwing money every month at high interest credit card debt, it's time you checked out Upstart, the revolutionary online lending platform that knows you're more than just a credit score. Now is the time to find out how low your Upstart rate can be to help pay off high interest credit card debt. Unlike other lenders, Upstart can reward you based on your education and your job history in the form of a smarter rate. You don't need a degree or a diploma to apply, though. Upstart lets you skip going to the bank because it's completely online. They offer loans anywhere from $1,000 to $50,000, so you can consolidate your debt into one easy fixed rate payment. Upstart makes it fast and simple to check your rate, and since it's just a soft pull, it does not affect your credit score. The hard pull happens if you accept your rate and proceed with your application. And the best part is if the loan is approved and accepted, most people get their funds the very next business day. Over 400,000 people have used Upstart to pay off credit cards or meet their financial goals. Free yourself from the burden of high interest credit card debt and get back to using your money your way with Upstart. See why Upstart has a 4.9 out of 5 rating on Trustpilot, and hurry to upstart.com/honeydew to find out how low your Upstart rate can be. Checking your rate only takes a few minutes. That's upstart.com/honeydew. Our next sponsor is Tushy. Now, everyone has an ass, and everyone deserves the gift of Tushy. Wiping your butt with dry toilet paper does not remove all the shit. If you got poop on any other part of your body, would you just wipe it with dry paper? No. Water cleans better than dry paper, my friends. Thankfully, there's now a sleek bidet attachment that clips onto your existing toilet and sprays your butt completely clean with fresh water. It's called Tushy, and it's the best thing you can do for your butt. I use mine all the time. It is the best thing you can do for your butt. Tushy sprays directly to your ass and removes the poop completely, so you aren't sitting on bacteria that leads to nasty things like hemorrhoids, yeast infections, UTIs, itchy assholes, and skid marks. Bidets are common in the rest of the world. A bidet saves you money on toilet paper. You still need a little bit of toilet paper to pat yourself dry, but the amount is negligible. It will not clog your toilets, and Tushy sprays your ass with fresh water. It's not toilet water. Tushy connects to the water supply behind your toilet to spray your dirty parts with clean, fresh water. It's the same water you brush your teeth with. Wet wipes are worse than toilet paper. They're terrible for the environment. They cause anal fissures, and you don't want your anus fissuring. It's only $79, y'all. All right. They also have an ottoman, the Tushy ottoman. It helps you get everything out. It's like a sexy tooth or cloud that helps you poop. And that's only $69, which is a really good price. So here's the deal. Go to HelloTushy.com/honeydew and get 10% off your order and free shipping. That's hellotushy.com/honeydew for 10% off your order and free shipping. Now let's get back to the dew.
He walked in, and when he walked in, like everyone looks, I saw like two dudes look down. Like, what the fuck is going on? And he walked in, hugged us, and then a black dude and a Mexican dude looked over at us. And I remember he looks at him, and they both just look straight down. I'm like, what the fuck is happening? So there's like a visit family room, and then there's a concrete slab brick room where you can walk around and do laps with who you're visiting. It's pretty big. It's like 30 yards. And we go out, and as soon as we go out, all the fucking three or four prisoner dudes get up, take their wives, go straight into the visiting room. So it's just us out there. So me, I'm like, what the fuck is going on? Like, nobody wants to be around us? Like, is this fool sick? What do I do? We're walking with you. And then when he passed the guards, I see the guards like look at him and look away. And I'm just trying to figure it out. I don't get it. And I asked my mom.
Is his head shaved at this point? No. He had long hair. Still long hair.
All the way down to his knees, like far. He had fucking the longest hair. And then I'll get to that. I asked my mom, like, why is everybody sitting down? Why does everybody leave when we go around? They look straight at the floor when we walk by. And why are we, you know what I mean? When I walked in, everybody's staring at us. Like, who the fuck are you here to see? My sister's dark. I'm not brown. My sister's darker than I am.
You are not. Listen, ain't make no sense. Way fucking the white walker, the king of the white walkers is coming over here to hug
no
the brown
fucking
kids.
Sense at all, man. And I have seeing the pictures now, like little fat little kid with him smiling. It's like, what the fuck is going on? So I asked my mom, and she just says nothing. She didn't tell me shit. So he gets out 2-3 years later. I'm older. I'm like 12. My mom and him get married, or a year or two later, they get married. They end up having a babe, but the baby didn't make it like 8 months-ish. But it's my stepdad. He's going to all these places trying to get a teaching degree in engineering because he's got all these degrees from being, he's been in prison. I didn't know this. 19 years of his life, he's 35.
Holy shit. Your mom's having a baby. He's going to prison, 16.
Wild, right? So
what was he in for?
Okay, so the first things he tells me, he was doing like robberies with his friends, and he went to jail on his 18th birthday and got transferred right to the big house. He basically said, I had to be around grown men on my 18th birthday, and he told me some crazy things, but that's why I said I don't say his name because he's back in jail, but they're not together. They haven't been together for 12, 15 years. No, almost 20 fucking years they haven't been together. And he's told me some crazy shit, man. Like being a kid, like pretty blue-eyed kid at 18, not hard at all yet, not scary. He's told me some, when they were starting divorce, I started going with him on the weekend. Like it was like my dad. My dad was never fucking around.
So your dad would just get mad that you guys were around guys like this, but he would never show up
once or twice, maybe every 2-3 fucking months.
Fuck you doing bringing my kids around
but
these little.
Always working.
I ain't coming, but get some new guys in here, goddamn.
Exactly.
Just get somebody.
As a kid, I'm just happy he showed the fuck up. I'm hyped. We'd do anything and it'd be fun, you know? Mm-hmm. But he was always working. My dad's nonstop truck driver. Never not worked. Goes to school, all that shit. He's just on one. And if he doesn't want to be around us all fucking on, he just doesn't show up. But he did a lot, so it pissed me the fuck off. So this is my stepdad. Was like my dad. I lifted weights with him. He like showed me stuff. Like, you know, we lived with him. Mm-hmm. So I'm about 12 or 13. They're getting a divorce. They're not. It's not going because he started doing meth. This fucking guy started doing meth and shit. I didn't care or know. I just knew they were getting divorced. So I go out in the country to his mom's, way out in the fucking boonies. The lady, you know those older white ladies that survive on cigs and Pepsi only?
Diet Pepsi,
you know
cigarettes,
I mean? Like
and Planters peanuts.
Anything almost.
Yeah, my mom's mom was like that. I'm like, well, do you eat Grandma DeVito?
Nothing. I just survive on sugar.
Like, cigarettes, Diet Coke, and fucking Planters peanuts.
You know exactly what I'm saying.
That was the meal.
Yeah.
Every now and then, like a tasty, like a
hostess of some
kind.
Yeah, exactly.
A coffee cake.
Yeah, exactly. A snowball.
Yeah, that was one of my girls. Yeah.
So we went out to his mom's. That's that lady. And she comes out, like, super hick out of a trailer. Like, all right, sick. We're staying here the weekends. Ugh. And I go in. They're nice, great. So me and him camp out in the country for 2 days. And he's just telling me all this shit. Because he's like, you know what? In case we don't, I'm still your dad. You know, because I've known him for 6-7 years, and that's when he starts telling me about all the prison shit and why everybody wouldn't look around. And so basically he said 18th birthday, he knew he had to do some shit. 18th birthday, he walks into fucking prison and he's like, nah, dude, I'm small. He's not a big guy, but when my mom met him, he's a fucking like the most shredded person on the planet. Like just
it's like beast. Fucking American History X
dead
shit.
On. Yeah. I think my mom just like my mom loves Edward Norton. She's obsessed with him. Like, do you just have a crush on fucking white people? Because you don't have to get the Nazi fucks. You don't have to do that.
Yeah, you don't
like,
have to.
The fuck's wrong? I talk shit to her every day. Every time I see her, just I don't hold a grudge, but I'm gonna talk shit to you every time I talk about it. I love it. She's gonna get so fucking pissed about this. But it's great. He's just a shredded motherfucker, but not as a kid. So he told me, he's like, I'm a skinny fucking kid. I was doing robbery. I wasn't fighting people. And he tells me that like the best thing you can do when you get to jail, if you want to be down, but you're scared, go stab a rapist or go get a pedophile. Just fuck them up. So do whatever you can in front of somebody and you're okay. You're going to get talked to. Somebody's going to get talked to after you come out of a hole. And he said straight up, he walked up to the guy with his little plastic fork and just started stabbing the guy in the neck. But he said it was a Chester, so I didn't give a shit. Like, what the fuck does that mean? He explained that Chester is like a molester.
Yeah.
Fuck. And I tell him, that's fucking sad. That's mean. Why would you just stab somebody over that? Like, you know, as a kid, I'm super nice. I don't like to fight. I'll fuck you up. I just don't want to I don't want to do that. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
You don't ever want to hurt people, ever. Talk it out. But when he told me that, I'm looking at him in a whole different light. Like, what the fuck are you talking about? You just stab the man in the throat? He goes, yeah, I just... till it tried to open up and they pulled me off. But as I'm leaving, all these Mexican fools are like looking at me like, fuck yeah. Because he spoke fluent Spanish and this makes sense why. Do you see
you
the connection now of why he's with my mom? It's
a
okay.
White supremacist.
Fluent Spanish.
Who speaks
bro.
Fluent.
Fluent Spanish, man. It's almost just like a cartoon, right?
And you know, you got the skin color and everything.
Oh,
and
he tried to teach me too. See?
Oh, come on. You had a white supremacist trying to teach you Spanish.
I didn't think about it like that.
That's the most ridiculous shit I've ever heard in my life. You got to roll your R's, man. Come on, man. That's what you call an ennie right there, okay?
You hear this? You're dying over here.
Oh fuck, hold on.
Yo, saying this shit out loud is so much different than just thinking about it.
It's different. Listen, living it, it's all different when you start talking about it, man.
Yeah, so yeah, I guess shit. Yeah, he did try to teach me Spanish.
Okay, so wait, he goes in.
Oh,
stabs
so he says
the guy,
he stabs
they're pulling him
man.
Off. He's going in to set a precedent. Like, look, I'm going to go after the piece of shit we all don't like anyway.
Exactly.
Let y'all know I'm not a bitch. I'm down. I'm here.
Well, that's what he's explaining to me. And I'm telling him, like, are you fucking kidding me? Because I'm so nice. Especially
y'all don't got
to
worry about me. I ain't going to say shit.
But he always
I'm
told me,
do
like,
my time
ever,
off
he always
top.
Used to tell me, don't ever go to jail. He always would be like, you're too fucking nice. Please don't ever go to jail. That's all he used to tell me. Scared the shit out of me. I mean, going to see him for years in prison.
So why are they looking down? Why are they scared of him? Or is it just a respect thing? What was it?
Oh, so this is what I'm building up to. He told me, he told me, when you get older, I'll tell you the rest. Because I was only 12 or 13. He said, when you get older, I'll tell you the rest. But by the time I was 14, he was gone. Like,
back in prison?
Just meth and just like running around town. Then now he's back. So, you know, but he told me, when you get older, I'll tell you the rest of it. But he told me stabbing that fucking man in the neck and it. Roast me the fuck out. He showed me how to throw knives. He's telling me the story as he's showing me how to practice to throw knives. I'm really good at throwing knives. From that weekend,
really?
I'm really good at it. Randomly, like how to balance it. He showed me how to balance it here, and you can. I'm like, what the fuck would you learn this shit at, man? Teaching me prison moves, fucking 12 years old. But we're in the country. And
he's like, let me show you how to make homemade flour tortillas.
No, he did. Speaking he did Spanish. Shit like that. He did shit like that. He made weird foods like with random spread like jellies and
yeah,
shit.
Yeah, because he's a prisoner.
Yeah, he would make like jellies and like toast and weird shit on it.
Give me some toothpaste and some shoelaces. I'll make some waffles right here in a minute. Those prisoners can do anything, man.
Oh man, he could draw us right now. I mean, telling you, he's a talented motherfucker, man. When you have nothing to do, I guess you figure out some shit.
All right, so go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, you're fine. You're fine.
So he was, what did he build himself up to?
Oh, so he's telling me basically
the ranks.
I know what he was trying to tell me without telling me because I'm a kid and I know what he's fucking saying. I've seen movies. Well, I'm not stupid. And he's telling me basically, I write out plans in these books. This book right here tells you how to do this, this, this. So he basically told me I used to plan things and when people need to get stabbed or people need
in
to
the,
be killed.
You're talking about within the prison system?
He's like basically draws map. He's an engineer. He's mm-hmm. like, get the blueprint. This is where you're going to have him here. This is this, this. And then he's telling me, he's like, I planned people getting hurt. And that's how he said it. I planned people getting hurt. But in the end, I'm like, so you're stabbing motherfuckers. This is what you're trying to tell me. You're killing people in jail, motherfucker. That he didn't tell me, but I knew what the fuck he was saying.
Literally sketched out what he was saying.
That's what he said. He used to, so I basically draw it out to where you don't know where it's at. He doesn't know where the weapon's at, and it's over. Because a lot of people get killed in jail that aren't even on the news. You know that?
I believe it.
A lot of fucking people get murked in jail, and you don't even hear about it on the news. The shit he's told me is unreal in jail. Just like
what stands out? Yeah.
Right, this is the one that got me because I don't know if it's real, but he always had this like little diamond earring, and he always had it, and he always said, "Yeah, I found this in jail." He always used to say that, "I found this in jail." And that trip we were camping, he told me what happened. He said this black dude had life and he was real young and he said he wasn't down. He was getting beat up and the fucking guy jumped in front of one of the trucks that come to get the trash. And he said, I saw this guy's head just pop.
Oh, he killed himself because he wasn't going to.
Yeah. He's got life as a little. He's fucking 19 years old. And he's like this. He said people do it all the time. People kill themselves all the fucking time because they can't handle it in there. I understand.
That's hell sad. Yeah.
It's
yeah.
fucking sad. But I'm 12 and I'm trying to figure out. You take me to the movies, man. What the fuck are you talking about? You kill motherfucker? He didn't say it, though. He never said he killed anybody. Because he knows better than that to tell a kid, yeah, I murder people. He never said that. He always said, I plan people getting hurt. Or and he said, I stabbed him in the neck. He didn't die. That's what he told me.
So he saw this kid jump.
He said he saw it. And then he said when he went over there, he had two little diamonds in his teeth. And he's like, I picked up his tooth. I put it in my pocket. In his ass. He put it in his fucking ass.
Yeah, up his ass.
And then he said, here it is. And I go, that's not true. I go, I'm telling you. Not true. Can't be fucking true. It's disgusting. You rock around. Gross, motherfucker. So, yeah, that was him. He was a wild man, dude. So many instances with him, like, around town. I live in a small town.
So you're saying in prison, white supremacists, outside of prison, not.
My best friend was black growing up. His dude named Justin. His dad is the head detective of our town. I mean, do you watch UFC?
Yeah.
Do you remember Marvin Beastman Eastman?
I don't.
Oh, he's a small... Well, Beastman Eastman, his older brother mm-hmm. is who I'm talking about. Okay. He's from Merced and he's 6'4 monster. He gets out of jail. We get a house right next to my best friend and I'm fucking hyped. Like, it's my best friend. He's down the street, two blocks away. I go over there with him, with my stepdad, and his dad's outside and it's just stare down. They just start looking at each other.
He's like, I just don't like Jews.
Oh, get the
fuck out of here. I just don't like Jews. You all are fine. No, yeah, no. My wife's Jewish, but other than that, I don't like any of them.
No. This is the thing. He explained it to me.
Hablas español? Yeah.
Yo, everybody speaks Spanish, but
yeah,
man.
Except for you. Fuck, even the white supremacists.
Yeah, everybody fucking speaks Spanish. I need to learn.
That's literally when everybody uses the term everyone speaks and... That is if he is speaking Spanish, you don't have an excuse, bro.
Flea market's no problem. Getting deals,
talking them down and shit.
Yep. White dude, fucking blue eyes. Fuck. My mom don't speak Spanish, so we don't know what the fuck he's saying to anybody. Oh, shit. Oh, God. Fuck. Oh, yeah. So they stare at each other, staring at each other. And they go talk to each other by my friend's dad's car. Me and my friend Justin are just with the footballs. What the fuck is happening here? 2 minutes later, they walk away and they're smiling. Everything's fine because they know each other. My stepdad is a fucking criminal. They know each other. He's a detective, but he wasn't always. He was a police officer. Mm. They know exactly who each other are. So when we go home, I go, hey, what happened? He says, me and him have been in a few fights. We know each other. Everything's fine. I'm like, damn, that motherfucker, you fought him? Because I've heard stories about my stepdad beating the fuck out of people. And my family has seen him, like, just randomly. So I don't doubt that he's kicking people in the face.
He ain't a big fan of Hanukkah. You know what I'm
saying? No, not at all. But he's, I mean.
Couple more weeks. We'll be
it's very, it's, he always told me race doesn't matter out here. He's like, your best friend's black, right? He's like, I love him. He's like my son. doesn't matter. In jail, whole different fucking story. And that's why he said, when people look down, it's because they know not to fucking look at me with my brown ass kids. That's what it was. Like, don't fucking say anything. I could only imagine what happened after, you know, after the fucking visiting hours are over. Because I can see him down the hall through the glass door getting uncuffed. And he didn't have the same face he has when he walks into the room. You know, like he looks like a scary motherfucker and walks out and say, what's up? Called my mom and she had to go get sandwiches. And you know what I'm saying? That was it. It's a weird time because he raised me with my mom. My dad was there periodically, but he was always pissed about it.
You know? Turned out so nice. You did. Yeah. You turned out so kind.
It's because I don't want to hurt people, man.
Yeah.
That's not fun. Like, that's not fun. I've been in very few fights and all of them were not my fault. You know what I mean? I didn't start that shit ever. But he showed me how to box and barely retained any of that shit. I don't remember any of it. But he's a scary ass dude, but very cool dude.
What about is it your uncle that you accidentally had this smoke session with? I just want to reset for a second. So you're introduced to quite a bit at a very early age, from drugs to split family to domestic violence to prison to white supremacy. Clearly not introduced to Spanish speaking people.
My whole family speaks Spanish but me.
Nuh-uh.
My whole family.
You didn't grow up? I thought
my mom raised me.
Oh,
my mom's the Jewish side.
So you too don't speak Spanish.
My sister speaks Spanish. She retained that shit because they were together till she was like 5, but I was only like 3.
Your mom don't speak Spanish. Everyone else does.
My dad, my grandma, my grandma.
Stepdad.
Yeah.
Everybody.
Everybody, dude.
The dog knows Spanish. On that
side. But my mom's side, they're all like Marcias and Rons and Chains.
And Emily's.
Exactly. Right. Loretta's.
Gotcha.
So that's why the other ones are fucking Carlos and Jaime. They all speak Spanish.
Jaime, yeah.
They all speak Spanish.
There ain't a Jaime out there that doesn't speak Spanish.
You, I'll be at fucking Christmas and I'll just sit there. Just fuck, man. What are you guys talking about? Shit, I'll just leave the room. But my cousins my age, we all just, you know, English first. But it's like, growing up like that, fuck. They all look at me, Thomas. And my cousins are talking to me. What the fuck are you saying, bro? You want to play football? What do you want to do? It's Thanksgiving. I don't want to talk to you. It's very aggravating, man. It's my fault. I need to learn.
So when, outside of seeing the cocaine, outside of knowing what your parents are doing with the meth and everything, when do drugs enter your world, your body?
Oh, okay. The day before the Raiders got their asses whooped by the Bucks in the Super Bowl. Remember that?
Yeah, I sure do.
12,000 fucking interceptions. The night before that, my sister.
How old are you?
13.
Okay.
My sister, I smoked trash weed out of a Mountain Dew can with her. And then I watched Mad TV and then Saturday Night Live. And I drank so much Tampico juice. And that was the first time I ever smoked
weed. What's Tampico? What is that?
It's really shitty Mexican juice. It's really bad.
Like homemade?
No, it's from the store. It's $1 for a gallon. You know what I mean? It's not good.
I know that.
But I drank the whole fucking thing, right? But before that, I was anti-drug everything. I had straight A's. I played football, played sports, math student of the year shit. But I started smoking weed, and I got my first B. And that's when it all went bad. I never got over 1 point anything again.
No?
It was all bad. Because I didn't give a fuck. I was always in the gifted programs, like the fucking nerd kids. Mm-hmm. I was in all those classes. Because I lived in the ghetto, but I had to go to the nice part of town to go to my classes for elementary. So I had to get on a bus. And none of my friends were there, you know? So drugs started with my sister. It was just weed. I started smoking weed heavy in eighth grade. Because that's when it happened after the Raiders. And it just kind of just got too, it's fun. You smoke weed now. I smoke weed now.
That I shit. Didn't until I got a late start.
When?
First ever tried it was 18. A kid rolled a joint. Wow. I took one hit. The whole joint broke in my mouth. He's like, just fucking eat it, because he didn't know how to roll. So I ate it. So that was, I can't even say I smoked it. I didn't smoke it. I ate that joint.
That was your first experience?
First ever experience. Second time was a few months later. We were at a backyard party, and I went to take a hit off a bowl, but it was already ashed. So, and then again, I didn't do it till I was 21.
Wow. Yeah. Good for you. That's fucking awesome.
I got in there late.
That's great.
But I think also at the right time. I don't know if I'd have been the same person if I'd have started smoking weed at 13, 14 or whatever.
No, I know what you mean. But my mom, like I said, nobody ever knew I smoked weed because she will fucking stab me. You know what I'm saying? She'll fuck me up. So I smoked weed with my sister. Ninth grade comes, I'm still playing football. And then 10th grade, this is where it all changed for me. I'm smoking bowls with my friends, putting in $5. We're trying to smoke bowls before football games, you know, smoking out of cans and bullshit. And I'll never forget it, man. I bought a 10 sack of weed from this guy at school, 10th grade, like the first week of school. And I had a 10 sack of weed in my, oh shit, I'm gonna get high as fuck today. And this random girl I knew came up to me and asked me if I knew where to get weed. And like the fucking, my brain split and said, just fucking sell half of it to her for $10 and make your money back. Sold half of it to her. Another girl came up, or another dude came up to me and asked me for a 15. I just, yeah, it's already weighed out. And I made $25 off $10. And I stared at it. And I looked around for my friend, my best friend Joe at the time. That's why I would smoke weed with. And I told him the situation. He didn't believe me. Look at the money. I only had $10. We bought an ounce after school that day. Bagged it up.
Where are you getting an ounce back?
This guy named Sam. He's an older guy, plays football. He had really trash. Well, I thought it was great. He had really bad weed. He sold us an ounce for like $250. Back then, we got played. It was like $150 at the time. Anyway, we got the sack, and me and Joe looked at each other. Like, we don't have a scale. We can't ask anybody to buy us a scale. We're going to eyeball this shit. So we got plastic wrap and made our own little bags. Like, yeah, that's about 10 bucks. Like, that's about 20. And then I'm super cautious because my mom will fuck me up. So I'm not going to get caught with weed at all, ever, nothing.
Let's take a quick break and tell you about our next sponsor, Keeps. 2 out of 3 guys will experience some form of male pattern baldness by the time they're 35. And the best way to prevent hair loss is to do something about it while you still have hair left. You used to have to go to the doctor's office for your hair loss prescription. Now, thanks to Keeps, you can visit a doctor online and get hair loss medication delivered right to your home. They make it easy and they deliver your medication every 3 months so you can say goodbye to pharmacy checkout lines and awkward doctor visits. All right, Keeps offers generic versions of the only 2 FDA approved hair loss products out there. You may have tried them before, but probably never for this price. Prevention is key. Keeps treatments can take up to 4 to 6 months or more to see results, so it's important to act fast. And the sooner you start using Keeps, the more hair you'll save. Find out why Keeps has more 5-star reviews than any of its competitors, and nearly 100,000 men trust Keeps for their hair loss prevention medication. Keeps' treatments start at just $10 a month, plus for a limited time, you can get your first month for free. All right, so here's what you got to do. If you're ready to take action and prevent hair loss, go to keeps.com/honeydew to receive your first month of treatment for free. That's KEEPS.com/honeydew. Keeps.com/honeydew. Our next sponsor is Manscaped, who is the best in men's below-the-belt grooming. Manscaped offers precision-engineered tools for your family jewels. They obsess over their technology developments to provide you the best tools for your grooming experience. Look, I've talked about it before. I definitely Manscaped, and I've used some other equipment before. And I mean, my balls have been bloody. My taint's been tattered. Like, it's no joke down there. You get some skin caught in that razor. Good night, Irene. All right. So Manscaped has redesigned the electric trimmer. The Manscaped engineering team spent 18 months perfecting the greatest ball hair trimmer ever created and just released the new and improved Lawnmower 3.0. Their third generation trimmer features a cutting edge ceramic blade to reduce manscaping accidents thanks to Manscaped's advanced skills technology. When I tell you this is premium, I mean it's premium. The battery will last up to 90 minutes so you can take a longer shave. The water-resistant technology allows you to groom in the shower. One of the coolest features is a little LED light which illuminates the grooming area so you can get a closer, more precise trimming. And let's not forget about the charging stand. This one comes with a charging stand. You can show your mower off loud and proud because this intelligently designed stand is a convenient charging dock powered by USB. All right. So if you're listening to me speak right now, I want you to experience it firsthand for yourself. Trim that junk of yours. Get 20% off plus free shipping with the code HoneyDew at manscaped.com. Your balls will thank you. All right. That's 20% off and free shipping with the code HoneyDew at manscaped.com. Now, let's get back to the dew.
So it made me become like a little fucking little piece of shit, honestly, because on Sunday, I went to school and stashed it all over school, my whole ounce. Like, I put some in the wood shop.
What?
Yeah, because I'm not going to carry it.
Right, but this is where you're putting it? You're keeping it at school? This is what I
did. Drain pipes, because at the bottom, they have that little piece of metal inside. Mm-hmm. So I just put it in the drain pipe underneath. I put it in the drain pipe all
How
around.
Many bags do you think?
30.
Yeah. 30 scattered bags around your school.
All around school.
Yeah.
First day, first lunch, sold every fucking bag. Me and Joe sold every bag. He's super pretty. He
got in all middle school?
No. 10th grade.
10th grade.
First, like, week of 10th grade. And it was the most fun I ever had. Me and him, he wanted to carry it on him, but my mom will fucking kill me if she finds out I have weed, smoke weed, and I'm selling weed. It's over. I'm like I said, she'll knock me unconscious. Yeah. This is before she punched me in the face and I realized she ain't shit. Because that's when I realized, like, you don't hurt. But I was still scared. So we stashed it all over school. Wood shop has all their wood pallets outside. So I stashed it, like, okay, three steps, put your arm in. Three steps, put your arm in. Yeah. So that's how we did it every day, man. Every day.
For how long?
Like 6 months until Sam couldn't get weed anymore. And then we're just like, all right.
Well, so you did it because you couldn't get weed anymore, not because you got caught.
And
that was
smoking for free. And I stopped because I couldn't get the good weed anymore. And then it got to, well, I spent all that re-up money on drugs and alcohol. I guess I'll get a 10 sack. And then we found it in a connection. We started selling weed again. That's really what happened.
In the school.
Yeah, fuck. I would go up to every group. You need weed, let me know. And I'd walk away. You need weed, let me know. But look at me. I don't look like I have weed. It looks so nice and just polite.
And you didn't know these kids.
I fucking knew everybody. It's a small town.
Okay.
And if I got in trouble, I'd know who the fuck did it. Right. Like, I went to all those groups. I want to go see who's looking at me weird, and that's you. But no, I would never have weed on me. I always had money on me because they'd be like, I mean, 15, like, go and get it from the drain pipe, and then that's it. It was really, really good, man. It worked a lot. It worked well. But
You would send them to go get it themselves.
No, I'd go get it. I don't want them to know my spots are.
Yeah, okay, because when you say go get it from the drain pipe, are you telling them?
Oh,
okay.
No, fuck no. Just go get it and not pay me. Hell no. And then one thing that scared the shit out of us, we stopped selling at school. The drug dogs always came. They always came to our school. It's fucking Merced. They search the lockers and walk around our school, touch all the backpacks with the dogs while we're learning and shit. It's fucked up. But, I mean, I wasn't paying attention, but you know what I mean. Somebody told me the drug dogs were there. I was in metal shop. And I'm in fucking metal shop. Where am I going to hide this weed? I have an ounce of weed in a bag in sacks. And I ran to the metal shop bathroom and I just fucking taped it to behind the toilet and I just sat there. Drug dogs came. I just sat there scared, just petrified, man.
God.
Never brought it to school again. I was too scared.
Did they find it?
Fuck, no, they didn't.
So they probably weren't even weed dogs. They're probably looking for harder shit.
I think if anybody did walk the dogs and any kid that did this, they were going to search. That's really what it was. They came a lot. Our school sucks, man. Our school fucking sucks. But that's when I started selling weed. It was fun times.
So, yeah, let's talk about selling weed because you sold a lot of weed. It sounds
when I got
like.
Older, when I got older, I started selling a lot of fucking weed, like to where
How
I
much?
Was nervous. I was breaking down pounds, so I was probably getting rid of like 5 or 6 pounds every 2 days, probably.
But, days?
Yeah, but like in sacks, like, oh, you want an ounce? Oh, you want an ounce? Oh, you want an ounce? I had a dispensary basically at my house. My older cousin came to my house to visit me for the first time. He's 15 years older than me. So he sees me as a little kid. He's, oh, you smoke weed? Let me come to your house. I had 15 fucking people in a line in my house waiting for, like, a dispensary before we had dispensaries.
And nobody was robbing, home invasion. You know
because
how many
I only sold
I
to my
know?
Friends. Wow. And the guy below, I moved to this apartment with my friend Jeebus. The man below me sold meth. I could tell right off the fucking bat because he was twacked out. 4 people came to his house and left. But, oh, so you sold meth. I know what meth is. My family does meth. So I knew exactly right off the bat, he's the groundskeeper. I know he ain't going to tell on me. I don't tell on you. You're stupid ass. You're selling meth, motherfucker. So he lived below me. So everybody that came into the little hallway looks like they're going to his house, but they're just coming to get weed for me and leave. And they're all my friends, and no one's allowed to bring anybody over. That was my thing. They're all my friends. Small town. Later on, it got to where I moved because motherfuckers were going to try to rob me. That's when I realized, like, fuck, man, these are no longer just my friends. Now people know. But I was on the internet, and that's why they knew. So I stopped selling weed when my page started getting bigger and stuff.
Because you were advertising on the internet, weren't you?
No, never advertised the sale of weed because I'm a jerk. I'm not going to, like, hey, cops, take that into court, me selling weed on the fucking internet. But no, it's been over 7 years. That's why I talk about the shit freely.
I thought you said you had the picture, you got taken down.
That was a long time ago. That was seven.
But you did that on the internet, right?
Yeah, but I wasn't selling the weed anymore.
Oh, it was after. Yeah, God, no. I see.
All my friends are they're massive grows, legal grows.
Got
legal
it.
Grows. So I'm like, okay. Hey, I want to do this picture today. Could you have 100 pounds of weed? And now I just do 100 pounds. But when I was 19-ish, I was selling pounds of weed like that. But it was more, I would never post on the internet. I didn't start doing the internet until I was 22 or 3. So before that is when all the shit was going on. I didn't have a fucking smartphone. I was a drug dealer. I don't want a smartphone. I had a little fucking Cricket phone. I paid $20 a month. I threw it away every so often, you know? But in a small town, there's not a lot of fireweed. So everybody kind of knows who the fireweed's coming from. Mm-hmm. And that's when it got to be like, okay, shit. Now you guys know what's going on. Because I used to deliver pizza. I always had a job because I'm not dumb. I don't want to get my door kicked in. So I used to sell weed out of my pizza car because I used to deliver pizza. So people would text me. I'd put my scale, my weed in my pizza bag. I'd walk up to their door, walk in, sell them weed, leave. Everybody thinks I'm selling pizza. There's no fucking pizza in the bag. It was the best time I ever had. I made more money at work doing pizza than any time in my whole life.
The customers just come to you.
My whole life, man. And I get paid for the gas. They pay me for my time and gas, man. I'm walking. I would just roll around in my pizza car, smoke bowls, and right when I get to the real pizza delivery, I'd open the pizza box and do that, and it'd smell like pizza everywhere. I'd walk up, no weed. I'd open the box to them so they don't. I never got in trouble for smoking, nothing. But I smoked 30 bowls a fucking day, you know, riding around selling weed and pizza. It was the best thing. It was better than the school thing. Like, that was easy. This is easy. I get paid to ride around. Nobody pulls over the pizza guy, man.
No.
No. I keep my sign on after work all the time and sell sacks every day. I would just keep it on at all the time. Nobody pulls you over. I got pulled over once. One time because my taillight was out in 4 years. You know?
And no problem with that either.
And my manager, his mom smokes weed. I'd sell her weed, so he's not going to tell on me. You know? I would just get high, and I did my job. So it was the most fun I've ever had. And then I was leaving a delivery. And I hear these, this is a fucking Merced. I know gangbang. I know if you're affiliated. I know if you're a northerner. I could see it on you. I know where you're at. I hear these fools as I'm pulling away. That's that fool that sells pizza, weed out of his car. And I heard it. And
you
I
heard just that.
Went, fuck. All right. You fools know about this. This is not good anymore. And I quit like 3 weeks later, but it wasn't because of that. But I remember hearing that made me like reevaluate everything. Because I've almost gotten robbed many times.
I'm sure, yeah.
No, just for pizza.
Oh, for the, yeah.
And they know they would get all my weed in my car. And that would have been the worst, to take all my weed.
This apartment that we lived in Baltimore, we didn't know it until we moved in, but we ordered a pizza from Papa John's. And they're like, where you live? We give the address. Like, oh, no, man. We don't deliver there after dark. We're like, what?
Damn. Oh, in Baltimore.
After dark.
Oh, I understand.
They're getting robbed left and right. Yeah, yeah.
That's what happened to me. The people were getting robbed a lot. I was on a pizza delivery. My manager that week told us the whole thing. Two pizza people in Merced, small town, that got robbed at gunpoint already. One got his ass whooped because he didn't give up his fucking money bag. There's only $20 in that fucking money bag, man.
Yeah.
What's wrong with you? He had his ass whooped. Another lady just got robbed at gunpoint. So I go to Loughborough. It's a bad street in my town. I go to Loughborough. I'm pulling up to the house, and there are four or five dudes, and all just, you could tell, all of them been in prison. All of them just got the fuck out because they're still rocked out. You know? There's a couple of skinny meth head looking dudes with them too, but two or three of the guys were fucking big. I'll try, but I'm not going to be able to win. Nothing weird. They just looked at me when I pulled up on my pizza. I pulled up. It's an apartment. It's an apartment like a condos. Mm-hmm. So there's one door, two door, three door, all flat, you know? And one big block. So they're one next to me. I walk up to the one next to him. Hello. You know, me in the pizza bag, just trying to be nice, high as shit. Knock on the door, just waiting, nothing happens. I knock on the fucking door, I look at these guys, and they're all just staring at me like this. They're all looking at me, I'm like, fuck, I know that look, shit. Please open the door, like, come on. And I knock on the door, and as I knock on the door, I'm looking, and one of the blinds is kind of open, and there's nothing in the fucking apartment. It's completely empty, nobody in there. And I click, like, these fools called the pizza, fuck. I wanted to just run away, but my car's right there with the key. You know, I'm not getting away. It's a cul-de-sac, by the way. I'm not getting away. There's a creek on the other side. I'm done. As soon as I realize, like, fuck, I don't look over, and I can already, like, hear them walking. And they walk onto the lawn. Two guys start walking behind me, and I turn around, like, hey, what's up? Like, fuck, man. And I was ready to go, here, take it,
fuck that car. You want the car? That car sucks. Take it. Yeah. I am not getting jumped by all you guys today. I got shit to do. I am, you know what I mean? I don't want to do this. Fuck this job. They all, two guys get next to me right here. Three dudes here. I was like, fuck. I go, what's up? Two dudes, the skinniest dudes walk toward me. The littlest guys walk toward me. And as they do, I'm ready to go, here. I'm just waiting for them to say something. Like, nope, I don't want it. Take my money. Fuck you. It's not my money. And as I do, as I'm about to take my bag off my shoulder, my fucking friend from City League Football, he's a gang-banging ass fool. He went a different route. I'm nice. He went to the stab you route, you know? He comes out of the fucking apartment they're in, and I just... Oh my God, thank God. Like, I don't know if he's going to jump me too, but I just, at least I know who you are and we're good friends. I haven't seen you in years because you're fucking gangbanger. He's older than me. I don't chill with you. I'm good. He walks out, and as he sees me, you see his face go, oh, and he walks and splits the guys, goes, hey, Thomas, what's up? Puts his arm on my shoulder, goes, what's up? I go, hey, dude, what's going on, Jerry? We start walking. He's like, hey, man, how you doing? You should probably go. I go, all right. Go, yeah, get out of here. Get out of here, man, right now. I'm like, all right, man, good to see you. I knew what he was saying. I knew exactly what he was doing. I go, thanks, man, good to see you. Yeah, they're not. He goes, those fools are crazy, man. They're never even here. That's what he said. Oh, they always do that shit. He said it like, yeah, the pizza thing. I could see him doing this. I know what he's doing. He's like, yo, don't stab my friend, please. Like, I could see it on his face. Like, yo, get in my car. Later, man. I'm trying to play nice. Like, later, dude. I turn around. As I turn around, he's talking to all of them. Fucking Jerry, thank you so much. I was ready to
run. I got anxiety hearing that.
It was so fucking scared because I'm not gonna let you just punch me in the face. I'm gonna start swinging, then I'm going
down swinging.
Then I'm gonna get jumped, yeah. You know, then I'm gonna get my ass whooped.
I'm going out fighting. I ain't going out like a man. Yeah, I'm not. Why?
I'm gonna give you my stuff.
If I'm gonna go out, yep. Why would I not let get exactly. A couple in? Hopefully.
You can have my stuff, but if you start hitting me, then I have to swing. But fucking Jerry, man, I saw him 4 years later. I was in Merced. I was at a stoplight, I wasn't working at the pizza spot, and this Cadillac rolls up, and no one's driving the shit. And I look, and this fucking gangster ass pulls up. He's laying all the way back in his car, like a fucking straight stereotype gangster. Hey, what's up, man? What's up, Jerry? Just tatted everywhere, like just gang shit all over his face. But that's my friend as a kid, you know? Mm-hmm. That's my friend as a kid with my stepdad that time, with Justin. We were all good friends, played football together. So seeing him and then seeing he had three kids with them, they all looked happy as fuck, but you're a gangbanging ass fool, but you're still awesome. And just seeing him completely tatted on his face and then thinking about him as a kid, it was just, what a change up. You hung out with those guys, I hung out with those guys, that's all it took. What the fuck?
Isn't that crazy?
Wow, man. I gotta, but he saved my life. I really thought they were gonna fucking just kill me. They all survived. And I'm not small. You're gonna punch me in the face and try to beat the shit out of me. It was scary. I'm scary as fuck. I told my boss he didn't believe me. Fucking asshole. Didn't even fucking believe
me. He's like, yeah, it's great. We got two pepperonis that need to get out now, man.
100%.
That's why they always are these assholes. Tell me the story about the first time you smoked crack.
Drugs?
Yeah.
So my first dabble into drugs was accidental.
Right.
Okay. No, another one. So when you're 14, 15, you're drinking, smoking weed, right? You're not really doing coke yet. Well, maybe you were, but I hit the coke heavy around 16. And
this 14, is so early.
Yeah, 14, 15. But yet. It's more sad. We're bored. Yeah. Man, there's nothing to do. Have kids? No, I'll just do drugs. You know, that's all we do there. And I'm at my friend Nate's house. We go there every, his mom's a paramedic, so she works night shifts. So that's Nate, Saturday, Sunday. We have to be out by 6 a.m. We can come over at 5 in the afternoon, and we get fucked up all night, clean up, and leave. Every weekend for 2 years straight. So this weekend, we go over there, and this fucking girl's outside smoking out of a weed pipe with this guy, Ryan, I know. I know this girl since 6th grade. They're We're 14. You expect weed. I have weed in my pocket. I'm like, yo, I'll pack a ball. It's packed. And I get it. And she goes, it's a cabbie. I don't know what the fuck that means. See that fit?
Mm-hmm. I never heard that one. But
I'm lighting it. It's a cabbie. Like, I don't fucking know what that is.
Cabbage patch kid?
Like, I don't know what the fuck she's talking about. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I hit it. I start smoking it. And as I start hitting it, I feel it like deep in my chest. I let it out. And I go, nothing's coming out. Nothing's coming out. And then a cloud out of nowhere. Like, that's not weed smoke. You know, have you ever seen people smoke meth in person?
Not meth, no.
Meth in person, it's like a cloud that sits. It's like a heavy cloud. It doesn't dissipate. It like, and then it goes away. So when I let it out, I just felt my head just go.
So your first drug experience?
It was meth.
Is meth.
This bitch, I go, what the fuck is in that? She goes, it's a cabbie, fool. I told you. I go, what does that mean? There's Chris on it. And I just wanted to punch her in the fucking head.
So it's weed with meth on it?
She just had Chris on it, like a bunch of crystal. It was packed. But when I'm smoking it, I don't know that.
Right. Who would?
In high school, you never roast the whole bowl. You hit corners. So it was really kind of black. I'm like, oh, I'm hit that shit. But when she tried to warn me, tell me the fucking name of the drug, you bitch. I'm not a tweaker. Why do I know your slang terms?
Right.
Right?
That's daffodil.
Exactly.
What's that? That's what's what we call heroin here. Exactly. Like, wait, what's
a flower?
Yeah.
Fuck you. So I started puking because I was real drunk off Tanqueray. Mm-hmm. Tanqueray and a orange clear Kool-Aid. It was nasty. What happened was I started feeling like my skin was itchy everywhere. I started feeling like I was rolling grass all hot. And you know, you
yeah,
like
oh
that.
Yeah,
like
yeah,
that's
yeah.
How I felt. I felt like I couldn't control every thought I had. I wasn't really high, but it made me a little like wired enough to start throwing up. And I just started just puking, puke my guts out. First time I ever did hard drugs, and that was an accident. Fuck that girl. She pissed me off. Fuck her. Anyway, the incident you're talking about, me and my Uncle John, my Uncle John's about 12 years older than me, right? He's my aunt's husband, so he's not related to me by blood. I met him at 10. He was 20, 21. So when I get 14, 15, I didn't know he gets high. And then he finds out I get high. You want to smoke weed together? Now thinking back, like, why are you smoking with a 14-year-old kid, man? What's wrong
for
with
real?
You? What's
yeah,
wrong with you?
Right?
But this is my uncle, man. That's my fucking uncle. Mm-hmm. I love that guy. And he always used to say, I'm never putting a powder up my nose because I started doing coke. And he was so mad. Because we smoke weed and get drunk together and drink High Lifes and shit. And he was so fucking mad. You're 15. Stop doing coke. He was so mad about it.
While he's smoking weed with
weed me. He's like, smoke weed, man. Like, this is what we do. Why are you doing fucking lines? He used to say that. Stop doing lines. He used to say that to me. I go, you would love it if you tried it. And I told him, it's like, it's amazing. What are you talking about? And he said, I've never put something up my nose until one fucking day we're drinking. And I finally got him to do a line.
You did? Just beating him down. He finally said, fuck it.
I had it. And he just, all right, I'm going to try that shit. He went. Ooh, and then he went, ooh. And then I chopped him one up, and I created a monster that day. He loved coke so fucking much. Wow, it got to where I'd come over, and I got a sack. Why do you have a sack? Oh, I got Brandon's number. Why do you have my fucking coke dealer's number, guy? Like, you gave it to me that night. Oh, fuck, I was drunk. But when I gave him the dealer's number, he lived 3 blocks away. And he's an adult. He has a job. He can afford it. I was a kid. I was getting coke every 4 days with my friends. So he's getting a bunch of coke months. We're doing lines. It was fucking awesome. And he started putting coke on his weed bowls and smoking it. I'm like, why? That's nasty. I told him, I'm not going to do that. So I'm drinking High Lifes with him. It's nighttime by his
Cocoa Puffs. We used to call it Cocoa Puffs.
Really?
I never tried it. This girl, it's always the chicks that would introduce me to the new. Yeah, she's like, we used to put coke on our weed. I'm like, why?
It's stupid. It doesn't get you nubs. It doesn't do nothing. It fucks your head.
I feel like you just burn it up. Yeah, crack on weed now.
It stinks. Yeah, so we're standing outside by his washer and dryer where we always do fucking lines at, and I watch for my aunt. Chops them. And then I go, all right, cool. We had a basketball court. We would pretend to play basketball. So as he's chopping
to play basketball.
Yeah, we play horse. Yeah. Play basketball means you want to do lines in the shed. That's what it meant. Like, you want to do lines in the shed, and we had a candlelight because there was no light. So we're fucking addicts. Just
no shit.
I'm fucking 15, 16, having a great time.
It's sad and romantic, to
be
honest.
It was fun, man. It was fun. But this is how the crack thing happened. He got a sack, and he starts putting it on a bowl. I tell him, no, I don't want to do it. I don't want to do it. He just got a coke sack. That's all I know. It's in the dark. We don't have a fucking light. And I go, all right, fuck. So I start roasting it. I remember where I was standing. When I start roasting it, I'm looking at it. I'm like, ugh. And as I smoke it, you know when people burn plastic to make, that's what it smells like. It smells like burning plastic, mm-hmm. But it was in my nose, like in my brain. I could taste the smell. I let it out, and I just got like a searing headache in both sides of my temples. Like it was shoving. And I looked at him. What the fuck did you just give me? He goes, it's coke. And I looked at his sack. 15 minutes later, we're doing a line. Man, it's all yellow rocks crushed up. He got fucking crack. didn't check the bag, sprinkled it all over the bowl, and I just started going in on him. Like,
no. Oh,
come on, motherfucker. You're talking shit to, you know what I mean? To give him the lecture, like, you didn't check your fucking sack. There was a little bit of white, but
whoever got it. He went from never doing coke or anything before.
Smoking bowls.
By candlelight.
In 6 months. It was amazing. It was amazing, man. It was a fun time. We used to ride around and pretend to look for jobs because he lost his job.
So
I was 18. No, he always had a good job. He just did drugs with me.
Yeah,
he just did drugs with me. It was great, and we would just ride around and pretend to look for jobs all day for a whole summer.
Jesus Christ,
yeah, he was fun.
We got to get you out of here soon, but I want you to share the story of the drive-by.
Oh, okay. Merced, like I tell you, everyone knows me. I'm nice. I sell weed. That's Thomas. Not many people named Thomas that are brown.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. Not a lot.
Mean Tomas?
No, Thomas. No, it's Thomas. Yeah, that's my grandpa, motherfucker. Okay. It's Tomas. I'm Thomas. And I know a lot of people. I know all the gang. I know gangbang. I know everybody, man. I'm from this town. We all grew up, and he's a gangbanger. Well, he's a fucking goth kid. He's a skater. Like, we all grew up together. And I'm standing at this place called H&W. It's a hamburger stand. I'm just standing, waiting for my food. Right? It's like the old school from the 50s diners. You know, like they'll come out and bring it to your window and shit.
What time of day?
It's 2 in the afternoon. My girlfriend's at the house. I tell her, thank God I fucking told her to stay home. I told her, no, just chill. I'm going to go get the food real quick. I ordered it in. Or no, I was going to go sit there and smoke a bowl while I waited for my food. Like, I had it planned out. I'm going to go get the food. Standing there about to order my food. It's a flat window. The main street is 5 steps behind us. You know, one of those. And I'm sure if you're from Baltimore, when you hear a whistle, you don't know. You don't fucking turn around. You hear someone yell, you don't turn around. I don't know who the fuck you are. You're going to shoot. Something's going to happen. So there's gang whistles. You know, I know what fucking gang whistles from where. I'm from there. I just hear a car going slow. And you don't go slow on this. It's a main road. I hear a car going slow. And I hear someone whistle. I'm like, nope. I'm not fucking turning around. And I hear someone go, hey, fuck you. I ain't turning around. And then I just feel. I hear a, and I feel. I am looking at the fucking lady ordering my food. I'm just ordering my food, and I can hear this going on. Like, don't turn around. Don't. You know better than that. And I feel like someone popped me in the back of my fucking head as hard as they could. I've never been hit like that. I remember I got hit, and some of my nose, like my snot came out of my nose a little.
Damn.
I felt like, you know when you sneeze hard? Mm-hmm. That's how I felt. And I remember sitting there thinking, somebody punched me in the fucking head. Like, I got furious. I'm super nice, but someone now, I thought maybe someone hit me with a bat. Like, it hurt. Damn. And I felt dink. But when it happened, a bunch of shit hit the front of the building. Like, a bunch of, I heard, like, a bunch of scatters. But I'm not paying attention to that. There's a girl next to me, hits the ground, starts holding her leg. I'm like, oh my God, did I just get fucking shot? I hold my head like this and I turn around. But I turn around like, oh my God, I'm shot. Damn it. I touch my head and I just feel like a ball. I'm like, oh my God, I got fucking shot. Are you kidding me? But when I turn around, I was still expecting someone that just cracked me with a fucking bat and maybe hit that girl. I don't see it. I turn around, and as I turn around, this fucking like Eldorado Cadillac is about 15 feet past. There's a 12, 13-year-old fucking little boy hanging out the window. Same haircut as me, hanging out the fucking window with a little hoodie, like half on, hanging out the fucking window looking at me, pulling in this little shotgun thing, pulling it in. And I remember like, oh my fucking God, I'm shot. I almost fucking started crying. Like, oh my God, this is it? Are you fucking kidding me? Because I was expecting like blood to start pumping through my fingers. I'm holding it and I go like that. And there's a little bit of blood, but not a lot. But there is a ball on the back of my head, right? Like a fucking fist-sized ball. And I look at the ground and there's like train track BB bearings. Those big metal bearings.
Yeah.
This fucking fool shoved it, pumped it out, and tried to shoot me in the face.
I have a shotgun?
I know the homemade potato guns I've shown you.
We used to have those. Ones. Yep.
The fucking kid. But he hit me directly in the fucking head.
Damn.
But if he hit me right here when I turned around, I'd be dead.
You would be dead.
But I knew better, like, don't turn around. Who's whistling at you in the nope. Everybody knows you, bro. They'll say, Thomas, don't fucking turn around. And then my first reaction, oddly enough, was, I probably sell your brother's weed, motherfucker. I'm going to find out who you are. Like, I'm going to find out who you are. I guess this street goes all the way down to the end of my town.
I can see these guys stop at a stoplight. Like, they don't give a fuck. They're just stopped waiting to go on the green. And I'm sitting there. I'm like, all right. Okay. And I say, fuck it. I get in my car.
But wait, at this point.
The girl's on the ground going, oh my fucking God. And I pick one up and it's a steely, a metal steely. And I realize, like, okay, I'm not dizzy. I'm going to get in my car and chase these fucks.
Because but the lady serving food.
The lady just went like that and got on the ground. All right. And she starts looking. And I go, and that's why I'm still holding my head. And I can see her looking at the girl. And that's when I started thinking, like, fuck, dude, I just got shot in the head. Are you fucking kidding me? But if I got shot for real, I think I'd be on the ground, right? But I thought at first someone
punched me. It didn't even knock you down or
anything. No. It made me step forward. Mm-hmm. But I tried not to, like, scream because I wanted whoever the fuck punched me to be scared when I just, oh, damn. You know what I mean? Because I was mad more than I was hurt. Mm-hmm. But as soon as I realized what happened, I, like, oh, my God, I'm shot. And I'm nice as shit, man. I'm fucking nice as fuck. Yeah. I don't want to hurt nobody, no, man. Yeah. I just want to sell you fucking weed. And I was still selling like a lot of weed. And my dealer at the time was, he had it in with these northerner fools and they were shooting at each other all the time. And I was thinking, fuck, do they think I'm down with this guy? And they try to shoot me, chase these guys. I called the fuck. I don't have a gun. I'm like, yo, these people are driving around shooting people in the head. You should probably go get them. This is the car. And the lady on the dispatch got so mad at me for not following them to their house. Because I got behind them, and as soon as they hit 12th Street, I go, oh, hell no, I ain't going falling on 12th Street. I'm going to get shot. It's a bad neighborhood. I'm like, this is where you guys are at? I'm going to let this one go. And I literally turned around. She's like, if you don't follow them, how am I going to help you? Like, no, bitch, I gave you the description of the car.
Yeah.
Because if I follow them to the house, what if it's a drug house and some of my homies are in there with hella weight and guns? I just snitched on all my fucking friends. Or people that are going to come kill me for showing up at the house with cops. I just let it go. Oh, sorry. I just wanted to let that one go. And as I'm turning around, I remember, like, all my pride just breaking, like, knowing this little boy tried to kill me. And I didn't know nothing about it. It was that's the most embarrassing moment of my life, was not doing anything about it because I wanted to ram their car. They had two grown men driving, like, fat, giant Mexican dudes, tatted, 30, 40 years old, with this little boy in the backseat.
Yeah.
Shooting fucking people. Because that year, like, six people got shot with guns, just in people driving by at the store, bam, just shooting real quick. The fuck? Some guy got shot in his driveway in the nice side of town. And that's when I realized, like, oh, it wasn't meant for me. It was for anybody.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
But thank God, man, I almost got fucking shot in the face, for real. Man. And that was the thing. I just remember thinking, I'm going to cut off their older brother with weed, whoever the fuck it is. Like, that's all I'm thinking. Like,
what did you ever find out who it was?
Never.
No.
Nobody.
Man, dude, you've lived a hell of a life so far. Now, I ask everybody that's new when they come on here, and I gave you a heads up before, advice to your 16-year-old self, and now looking back and hearing what you, and it's always interesting to me because Jess May Peluso said the same thing, like I've never put my shit together in a laundry list, never. And looking at it, you're like, God damn, fuck? That's mine? Yeah, so
yeah.
Advice you would give to your 16-year-old self.
Mine might be different, but almost none, because I fucking love the way it turned out.
Like, so the advice will be then?
My advice would be, like, get a contract, work out, you fat piece of shit. That's really it, because I used to be kind of fucking in shape when I was younger and started selling weed and stopped caring. That'd be my only advice. Like, hey, stay in shape, you fuck, and sign contracts before you do deals with people. That's the only deal. Only thing there's no other advice, man, because everything led up to me being fucking stoked. You know, nothing else. All those packs and 100 miles of drive, like driving with pounds and pounds is fucking frightening.
I mean, hearing about it gets me nervous.
It's scary, man. It's
you're just going up and down the freeways and shit with pounds and pounds. Oh, yeah, just going
to, like, SAC to LA, LA to SAC, dropping off packs on the way. It's drug dealer shit. It's you make money, but in the end, man, I got lucky. I never got fucking sent to jail.
I've had 50,
60 pounds. Because I've had friends get almost shot to death over a pound a week. Fucking $2,000? Are you kidding me? So that's my advice, is almost really that. Like, not much, man. Because I love everything the way it turned out. I think if I changed it, I'm just lucky. I have the coolest job ever. I really do. It's the funnest. I just get paid to get high and make stuff. Make content. Oh, you want to make clothes? Do it. You know, this. Good
for you, dude.
This is fun.
Yeah, it is fun. This has been a lot of fun, yeah. One more time, please. Yeah. Promote everything you'd like.
Dopeazyola.com, pushtrees.com. That's my clothing website. YouTube is Dopeziola. Thank you to everybody that follows us on there. We're about to hit 900. I'm very fucking excited.
Wow, that's great.
It's so, the fans are unreal, man. It's, I don't have tattoos. We have like 60 tattoos. People have blasted. I love all those people. That's really what it is that's what I want to plug. Thank you guys for watching so much. Thank you for supporting everything and letting me be able to get up and get as high as I can and go, well, work was fucking awesome today. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you so much.
You got it, thank brother. You so thank much. You. Appreciate you being here.
Appreciate it.
As always, Ryan Sickler on all social media, ryansickler.com. Make sure you subscribe to the YouTube. Talk to you all next week.